For more than 4 billion years, the moon has been Earth's galactic neighbor. From keeping the Earth's tilt stable to creating tides, the moon serves many useful functions just by being here. But the story of how it got here is not so harmonious as it is today. Violent impacts and destruction plague both the moon and Earth's histories, and the journey from even before the moon's formation to today is both long and intense. A little over 4.5 billion years ago, the moon did not exist. Instead, the solar system was full of possibly hundreds or thousands of small planetesimals, moon to Earth-sized objects that orbited the sun. This was a period of chaos. Collisions were frequent, and destruction was everywhere. Planetesimals slammed against each other frequently. The result? Either complete destruction, or, in very rare cases, a second option. This is the early solar system. After the last of the circumstellar disk dissipated and material accreted and combined together, we're left with the planetesimals of all sizes in many differing orbits. Here, we can see a young Earth. Just 100 million years after the formation of the solar system, scientists theorize that a Mars-sized object named Theia came just too close to the young Earth. At about 9 kilometers per second and a steep impact angle of at least 45 degrees, as evidenced by thorough mixing of the two protoplanets, impact occurred. As Theia's core sinks deeper into Earth, quintillions of tons of molten material are ejected into orbit. This ejected material quickly accretes or coalesces together under its own gravity. Surrounding Earth post-impact are tiny particles, all of which formed from either Theia or Earth or both. Within decades, these small objects combine enough to form one larger object, a proto-moon. As the moon orbits the Earth at just 1/12 the distance it is today, it begins to accrete or coalesce all the material surrounding it. What happens is, under the gravity of the moon, it begins to pull in all of the material in and ejecta surrounding the Earth. Thus, it begins to grow in mass and size. With an increase in mass, brings stronger gravity, and thus more material is absorbed. This is only limited by when the material runs out. Over the next centuries, the last of the material becomes absorbed by the moon. It begins to cool from its molten state into a solid body. Here, we can see how the moon accretes and absorbs the material over time. Take a minute to observe the time lapse and watch how the moon thins out the material surrounding the Earth. Thus, it accretes and grows. Within time, nearly all the material is gone, with most of it remaining at the Lagrange points, or equilibrium points, between the Earth and Moon's gravity. With the last of the material accreted, the Moon is now essentially the same size and mass as it is today. However, it orbits much closer than today as well. And Earth's rotational period is just 5 hours after the Moon's formation. But the moon's relative stability after its cataclysmic birth did not last for long. Soon it was hit with a late heavy bombardment, an annihilation of asteroids that rained down on the young Earth-Moon system, along with other inner planets in the solar system. For 300 million years, the moon was pummeled with an uncountable number of small objects, giving it the iconic cratered surface we know today. By 3.8 billion years ago, this bombardment came to its end, as most of the debris was swept away, likely by the larger gas planets migrating outward. Just before the end of the late heavy bombardment, one major collision occurred in the lunar south pole at what is called the Atacan Basin, an impactor 170 kilometers across, larger than Ireland, collided with the moon roughly 3.9 billion years ago. Ejecta, or lunar material, was spread thousands of kilometers from the impact site, and the basin that formed as a result spreads over a quarter of the lunar surface. This impact site is one of the largest known impact basins in the solar system, after only Mars's Utopia Planitia. In a period of teenage rebellion, the last violent stage in the moon's history, the now cratered moon began erupting in massive lava flows and basins. These flows can be seen today as the lunar maria, the dark features on the near side. Erupting around 3.5 billion years ago, most maria were active in this period for about 500 million years. However, some remained active until just a billion years ago. The reason for their existence is not yet known. However, some theories exist. Some scientists propose that large impacts, probably from the late heavy bombardment, disturbed and opened up the large underground magma pools. Another theory, though, believes that the Earth's gravitational pull, while still so close to the moon itself, caused these huge flows to occur. However, both have their respective issues, and more data needs to be collected. As the lunar core cooled, this period of volcanism died, and the moon became a desolate, dry land. Cooled of all magma, what was left over were craters, maria, extinct volcanoes, and many other geological formations. Except for small meteors colliding with the surface, no new formations were created. And the moon was essentially geologically dead. With practically no atmosphere, geological processes, water, or other forms of erosion, the lunar surface has remained largely the same for the last billion years. Only recently have humans made their marks on the surface as well. 12 men, all part of NASA's Apollo program, made footprints in the lunar regolith. Without their discoveries and resources returned from the moon, it is likely no knowledge of our companions' origins would be known. Surely other theories would exist, however, nowhere near would they be to the degree of accuracy as this one. This incredible scientific and technological achievement stands among no others. It is alone in its monumentality and will likely be unmatched for decades to come. And it is thanks to this that we know the origin of our moon.